We're so glad you've decided to join us here today at the Pickerington Church of Christ. We are here to recognize and acknowledge a very powerful Lord that we serve. As we take this time to reflect on the coming week and reflect on everything that God has done in our lives, let us be mindful to prepare our hearts and minds for the songs that we're about to sing, for the prayers that we're about to offer, and ultimately, for the walk that we're going to be on with Jesus Christ in this next hour.
This is the day, this is the day that the Lord has made, that the Lord has made. I will rejoice, I will rejoice, and be glad in it, and be glad in it. This is the day that the Lord has made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. This is the day that the Lord has made. This is the day, this is the day that the Lord has made, that the Lord has made. I will rejoice and be glad in it, and be glad in it. This is the day that the Lord has made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. This is the day that the Lord has made. Walking in sunlight, all of my journey. Jesus has said, I'll never forsake thee, promise divine that never can fail. Heavenly sunlight, flooding my soul with glory divine. Hallelujah, I am rejoicing, singing his praises, Jesus is mine. Shadows around me, shadows above me, never conceal my Savior and Guide. He is the light, in him is no darkness, ever I'm walking close to his side. Heavenly sunlight, flooding my soul with glory divine. Hallelujah, I am rejoicing, singing his praises, Jesus is mine. In the bright sunlight, ever rejoicing, pressing my way to mansions above. Singing his praises, gladly I'm walking, walking in sunlight, sunlight of love. Heavenly sunlight, flooding my soul with glory divine. Hallelujah, I am rejoicing, singing his praises, Jesus is mine.
Oh, the Lord, our strength and song, highest praise to him belongs. Christ the Lord, our conquering King, your name we raise, your triumph sing. Praise the Lord, our mighty warrior, praise the Lord, the glorious one. By his hand we stand in victory, and by his name we overcome. Though the storms of hell pursue, in darkest night we worship you. You divide the raging sea, from death to life you safely lead. Praise the Lord, our mighty warrior, praise the Lord, the glorious one. By his hand we stand in victory, and by his name we overcome.
Thank you so much for joining us today. Right now is the time in our worship when we want to enter into our time of communion and where we really focus on what it means to remember Christ. You know, we use that term a lot, to remember something, and especially when we get into this time, we want to talk about remembering Christ's death, remembering the price that he paid, remembering the cost that it cost the Father when he lost that relationship with Christ, when he took on our sin. As I prepared my thoughts, there were a few scriptures that came to mind. The first scripture I want to take a look at is the 103rd Psalm. It says, "Bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all his benefits, who forgives all your iniquities and heals all your diseases, who redeems your life from destruction, who crowns you with loving kindness and tender mercies, who satisfies your mouth with good things so that your youth is renewed like eagles." We often use that word remember to talk about the memories and the events and the things in our life that we file away in our memory. And we can recall them when we want, we can think about them, but that's not really capturing what the text is talking about here. Really, what the scripture is trying to impart upon us and trying to give us is that when we remember something, we make it central to our consciousness. You see, what happens a lot of times is we might experience an event, or maybe we watch a movie, or we hear a powerful sermon, or something that really captures our emotion and captures our intellect, and we leave that with a motivation and a drive to change something about us. I think all of us have probably experienced that. And most of the time, though, we know what happens days or weeks later is that event no longer drives us the same way that it did initially. So what happens then? Do we actually forget the event? Do we forget what happened? Do we forget the impact? No. But what happens is it's not central to our thinking. It no longer impacts the way that we're living. And so when we read in this text to remember, to forget not all of his benefits, it's telling us to remember in that way that we make it central to our daily lives. And so when we come to this time in our worship and we have the opportunity to partake of the bread, which represents Christ's body that was broken for us, and of the cup, which represents his blood that was poured out for us, we have the opportunity to continue to remember and make that central in our lives so that it doesn't just affect us here in the moment, but it affects the way we live daily. So how do we apply this into our thinking? How do we apply this into the way that we live so that it doesn't just become something that's filed away in our memory file cabinet, but it's something that remains central in our lives? I want to read one more passage, and it's Psalm, the 25th Psalm, verses 6 and 7. It says, "Remember, O Lord, your tender mercies and your loving kindnesses, for they are from of old. Do not remember the sins of my youth, nor my transgressions. According to your mercy, remember me, for your goodness' sake, O Lord." The way that we remember Christ, the way that we remember what he did for us so that it impacts us daily, is we remember that Christ is sitting at the right hand of God. And because of that, God can remember us. And he doesn't remember our sins anymore. He doesn't remember our transgressions and the ways we've displeased him. Why? Because that is central to who he is. And Christ is continually sitting at the right hand of the Father that he might remember that he's made a commitment of love to us. So as we partake, let's think of how we can remember what Christ did for us so that it impacts us in our hearts and continues to change the way we live. Let's bow in prayer. Our Father, we thank you so much for your Son. We thank you that you remember us because of what Christ has done for us. We thank you that you don't remember us according to our sins or our faults or the ways that we displease you, but that you remember us according to your loving kindnesses and your mercy. Thank you so much for what you do for us. Thank you for this memorial that we're about to partake. And help us as we partake of the bread to think of that body that was broken for us and the price that was paid on the cross. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's give thanks for the cup. Father, the precious blood of your Son has such deep and far-reaching impact in this world. And Father, though we pray at this time that we would make it personal as we would focus on what you've done for us individually and in how you have bought us back with that blood and that you, how you have redeemed us. Father, be with each one as they partake of that cup, that they might remember the price that was paid. In Jesus' name, amen.
As the Apostle Paul was closing up his letter to Titus, he added a few last but not least items. In chapter 3 of the letter to Titus, verse 8, Paul says, "This is a faithful saying, and these things I want you to affirm constantly, that those who have believed in God should be careful to maintain good works. These things are good and profitable to men." Then in verse 14, he says, "And let our people also learn to maintain good works, to meet urgent needs, that they may not be unfruitful." Faith in God generates good works. God's grace makes us grateful people, who in turn become gracious like Him. God is sensitive to what people need, and He wants us to be as well. Through our benevolent spirit, people experience the goodness of God. Paul said to approach our work as servants of Christ carefully. Carefully does not mean hesitantly or skeptically, but it does mean having wisdom and paying careful attention to what people's needs are and what is the best way that we can serve them. When we're careful And when we're generous, we will be much more effective shining the light of Christ in the world. In verse 14, he reveals a couple more details. Let our people also learn to maintain good works. In this verse, we see that maintaining good works is something we learn along the way. The longer we study the life of Jesus, the more we develop an eye for needs, the heart to help, and the wisdom to really make a difference. In order to meet urgent needs, we must be ready. Or else, while we're talking about helping, the window to help closes because it was, well, urgent. This is one reason why it is important to God that we take up a collection while we're together, so that we can prepare and be ready when someone truly needs it. Hurricanes, floods, fires, addictions, loss of jobs, these all require us to be carefully prepared. We can do a lot more together than we can individually. Finally, in verse 14, Paul equates meeting felt needs with being fruitful. When the Holy Spirit has mastery over our hearts, we will be impactful in people's lives and will give glory to God through our good works. Because God is a careful giver toward us, let us become careful and intentional givers toward each other and toward those who need to see the glory of God in their life.
Unto the hill of Calvary, my Savior went courageously, and there he bled and died for me. Hallelujah for the cross. And on that day the world was changed, a final perfect lamb was slain. Let earth and
Hebrews chapter 10, verses 1 through 4. For since the law has but a shadow of the good things to come instead of the true form of these realities, it can never, by the same sacrifices that are continually offered year after year, make perfect those who draw near. Otherwise, would they not have ceased to be offered, since the worshipers, having once been cleansed, would no longer have any consciousness of sins? But in these sacrifices there is a reminder of sins every year. for it is impossible for the blood of bulls and goats to take away sins. Good morning, everyone. And first, I just want to say thank you to the Pickerington Church and congregation here for asking me to be a part of your study today. It's always an honor to share the Word of God with His family around the world, and I've been truly looking forward to spending some time with you today. That said, I just want to say, you guys don't play any games. Generally, when I'm asked to speak somewhere as a guest, they'll give a softball topic or let me pick something that I'm comfortable with, but not pick town. You guys are headlong in a study of the book of Hebrews, and my job today is to parachute into chapter 10 and continue right along and pick up right where you left off last. Now that is a challenge. I love Hebrews, but Hebrews is deep. It's so rich. It's theologically challenging. Maybe outside of Romans, the most challenging read that I've had, even in my personal study and all the years that I've been studying the scripture. So with that being said, I'm not sure if the shepherds here have actually set this up to trap me or they just have a whole lot of confidence in me. But either way, I promise you that this will be something that is going to challenge you like it has me in preparing to share a little bit of time with you here this morning. So, this theme, Jesus is greater, that you've been looking at as you've studied through the book of Hebrews here, is a theme that I really, truly love. The Hebrews lived in such a difficult time, especially these Hebrew Christians, and they lived at a time where they were used to a certain way of living, they were used to a certain religious paradigm, a certain way of doing things, and they were in danger of sliding back to what would have been slavery for them, as it were. They were in danger of going back to a system. They were in danger of going back to a way of religious thought that would surrender their freedom, it would sacrifice their salvation, and in a really weird turn of events would sequester them or separate them away from the God that they were desperately trying to seek and have a relationship with. And as we come to this portion of text today here in Hebrews chapter 10, and then honestly, the surrounding context in chapter 9 as well, I think that it's important for us to remember that we also live in a troubled time. We also live in a time where we are also at risk of accepting a worldview that would surrender the true nature of the relationship that God wants to have with us. It would surrender the greater that He has accomplished for us. It would surrender the greater that He has called us to, and it would surrender the greater sacrifice that Jesus Christ is for us each and every day. Now, I know what is most present and possibly vexing to you at this point in time, and that is threatening in your minds, is this upcoming election that we're dealing with in a few days. And I know that looms over us right now, but as we dig into this text this morning, I want to suggest that the biggest problem that we have, just as the Hebrew writer will suggest, is not anything that could be going on around us. It's not anything that we face in a political environment, a socioeconomic environment. It actually has everything to do with what we experience internally. When we get really honest about it, our biggest problems usually come from within. And I think if you're honest this morning, it might even be part of what led you to this service. So, I want to bring us to the heart of this text and what it's striking at today, and I want you to think about a question. And as we dig through, I just want you to keep this in the back of your mind, and I want you to consider it. I want you to turn it over a little bit. I want you to chew on it, and hopefully what we pull out of the text today will bring you to a better answer than you currently have. Why does it always seem that it is easier to be forgiven than it is to forgive yourself? And even more pointedly, I want to ask, maybe you've even thought at some point in time, I know that God has forgiven me, but I'll never forgive myself. Have you ever felt like that? And maybe you've even been to a place where you've thought, I know that God says He can forgive anything, but I'm not sure that He could forgive this. Maybe something that you've done, experienced, seen, something that you blame yourself for, something that there have been consequences for. Let's read the text one more time. Dealing with Hebrews chapter 10, verses 1 through 4, which read, since the law is a shadow of the good things to come instead of the true form of these realities, it can never, by the same sacrifices that are continually offered every year, make perfect those who draw near. Otherwise, would they not have ceased to be offered, since the worshipers, having once been cleansed, would no longer have any consciousness of sins? Can you honestly think of a time in your life when you've not had any consciousness of any sin? Any consciousness of something being wrong with you? Any consciousness of something being broken? Any consciousness of you falling short? It goes on to say, in these sacrifices, there's a reminder for sins every single year, referring to the Old Testament system of sacrificial worship, for it's impossible for the blood of bulls and goats to take away sins. So first, I just want to deal with the elephant in the room. We are talking about the Old Testament sacrificial system. We are talking about blood sacrifices and animal sacrifices in this text. And we find ourselves looking at this sacrificial system in today, in 2020, in our modern world. Sometimes it's easy for us to feel really distant from this way of life. It feels like something that we don't relate to at all, that we're not connected to at all. We might even see it as primitive or barbaric or something that we can't understand why it was ever necessary to begin with. At first glance, it might seem like this is something that the writer is writing about that we don't really relate to at all because it's never been a part of our experience and we're so culturally far from it that we can't even imagine it ever being part of our experience, even if we lived a long time ago. I'm going to argue, though, that it's actually a perfect picture of where we are today. I'm going to actually argue that this is a perfect representation of our current state of affairs. A couple things we need to remember, that if in the Old Testament you were going to go and worship God, you had to go to a specific place. And I don't mean the church building on the corner. What it's referencing is the tent of meeting or the tabernacle out in the wilderness before the temple was built. And if you're going to worship God, you had to go to the tabernacle. And if you wanted to approach the place where God actually was, where his presence rested there in the Holy of Holies, you actually had to pass not one, but three altars. Those three altars were involved in this Old Testament sacrificial system under the old covenant that was given through Moses. You had the altar of burnt offering first, then you passed the altar of incense, and then finally, inside the Holy of Holies, on top of the Ark of the Covenant, there was a thing overlaid with gold called the mercy seat, and that was also an altar because once a year, on Yom Kippur, the high priest, and only the high priest, could enter into the presence of God and offer a sacrifice for the people and their sin. So I think the first thing that we need to remember is that you couldn't just approach God. You couldn't just show up. The tabernacle, as it were, in the temple even, were not just a house of worship as we have come to see them and as we have come to think about them. But it was always connected to these sacrifices that had to be made in order for them to be in the presence of God, to draw near to God, as the Hebrew writer is talking about. They had to make these sacrifices, and they had to do these things again and again and again, day after day, year after year, over and over they made these sacrifices. But the writer confesses here in Hebrews, we're never able to take away sin. They were never able to deal with something that was even more closely related to how the Hebrews would feel about themselves and how we feel about ourselves today. More on that in a second. I got to ask the question because this is something that I know comes up, especially from our modern point of view when we say, but why sacrifices? Why blood? Why did it have to be that way? Isn't God just able to say, I forgive you because you have a repentant spirit and a contrite heart? Isn't that a little bit too much to require the blood of bulls and goats to begin with? What's this business about Jesus being a sacrifice or an offering for us? Did he have to die? Why the blood? Why the barbarity? Why the primitive notion of sacrifices? Why does this have to be a thing? And so to that, I think there are a couple things we need to think about. Number one, blood has always and will always signify brokenness in the world. When blood is flowing out of place, it shows how broken things are. This Old Testament sacrificial system that they were living under in those days was a way of learning that what was wrong with life on this earth in its fallen state was really wrong. That things were really, really serious, and that it's not something that we could fix by just trying harder or by being better or by being more moral or by following more rules. It's not something that could be, you know, educated out of us as humans. It's not something that we could fix with social problems. It's not something that we could fix with government or with programs. What is wrong here on this planet Earth since the fall in the garden is really wrong, and it's going to take something drastic and something radical to answer it. That's the first thing that we need to understand about the need for these type of sacrifices under that old system. But the second thing is that blood signifies the brokenness in us. The world is fallen. Yeah, we know that it's not a perfect world. But we also deeply know and cannot escape the reality and the understanding that we're not perfect either. We're broken. And the older we get and the more experience we gain, we usually come to understand that we actually have a lot of responsibility in this too. We play our part. We are part of the reason why things are so broken. Me, you, all of humanity. And so there's the fact that blood signified the brokenness of the world that we live in, that it separates us from God. And it also signifies the broken in us, the brokenness, the guilt that we all bear for being a part of this broken system and our separation from God too. And those two brokenness, if it wasn't enough, also connect to blood in this way. Blood always leaves a stain. And it's the most impossible stain to remove in every single instance. My wife loves crime documentaries, Forensic Files, NCIS, Law and Order, you name it. And what is really, really interesting is that in so many of those cases, whether they're inspired by real events or an actual real event that happened that's being detailed in a documentary, is that a lot of stuff can go down and the blood can be wiped up, but the stain beneath it remains. It's really hard to get rid of that DNA that is underlying. And there is something about this brokenness that is in our DNA as well. And try as we might, we're never able to quite get away from it and fix it. So due to those things, the brokenness in the world, the brokenness in us, the stain that that brokenness leaves, that guilt that it puts on all of us, the system of sacrifice in the Old Testament, whether it was in the tent of the gathering, the tabernacle, or in the temple later, signified the separation that existed because things were so broken between creation and its creator. It signified a divine divide, and blood was the only way through. Blood put things in perspective for the Old Testament people. Blood puts things in perspectives for us today as well. It seems archaic, it seems barbaric, it seems primitive, it seems horrendous, but it's actually the most accurate way of showing what our current state of affairs actually is. So, there's a guilt that comes with blood. The Hebrew writer is dealing with this in the first four chapters and also in chapter 9. There's also a shame that we have deep down inside, that stain that I talked about a couple seconds ago, that no matter how hard we try, we can't seem to wash it off and we can't seem to fix it. And this is what the Hebrew writer is dealing with in this passage. And this is how he's demonstrating Jesus to be a greater sacrifice than those that could not take away that problem and could not take away sin. I want to talk about our conscience for just a second. And we need to spend a few minutes here because in Hebrews, the word conscience is mentioned more than in any other New Testament book. There's something to the conscience that is a part of this whole system of forgiveness and guilt and shame and being perfected and sanctified in the image of Christ Jesus so that we can be fit to stand before God, even in our brokenness that we just finished talking about. What we experience in this life is so far disconnected from the sacrificial blood system that we, like the priests who were in the tent or in the tabernacle, sometimes find ourselves doing things over and over and over again, trying to address and trying to put to rest what the scripture calls an evil conscience in Hebrews chapter 10 and verse 22. A conscience that leads to dead works in Hebrews chapter 9 and verse 14. And a conscience, according to Hebrews chapter 9 and verse 10, and again in chapter 10, that could never be put to rest. Never rest in the peace of God, could never be subdued from ringing the alarm that something is very wrong with us. And no matter how many religious rites that they performed, and no matter how many times they walked in and offered sacrifices, and no matter how many times we show up to church or Bible study or say our prayers or do all the other religious things that we think put us right in God's sight, it never seems to fix the fact that deep down we feel like we fall short. Seems like we're just not okay. So the old sacrificial system offered forgiveness, but the biggest problem we learn from the text here in Hebrews chapter 9 and 10 is that it could never purify or cleanse the conscience of the worshiper. It's a word that means how fit we feel in our self-evaluation, how fit we feel to be in the presence of other people, or how fit, in this case, we feel to be in the presence of God. That's what this word conscience actually relates to. So put simply, here's what the Hebrew writer is getting at when he talks about an evil conscience or a conscience that's unable to be purified by these Old Testament sacrifices. And I'll do it with this question. Are you fit for the presence of God? Are you fit to be in the presence of other people? And just stop and ask yourself that question. Be honest. When you woke up and you looked in the mirror this morning, maybe you're sitting on your couch in your PJs tuning into this church service right now and you didn't have to worry about how you looked in front of other people, but there's something instinctive inside of you that knew if you were going to actually go out the door of your house and be around other people, you would feel unfit unless maybe you put some makeup on, maybe you put a certain type of clothes on. And you might know that those are just surface things that don't really matter in the end, but still there's this thing, this stain that you can't shake, that you, as you are truly yourself first thing in the morning, are not fit to be in the presence of other people. If you don't feel fit truly in your conscience to be around other people and authentic and transparent in who you are, then it's probably a stretch to expect that you actually feel fit to be in the presence of God either. So this conscience that we all carry with us, a bad conscience, an evil conscience, the text says, is actually our biggest problem. If you don't see how this is your biggest problem, then let's continue for just a little bit. What the scripture calls an evil conscience in Hebrews chapter 10, verse 22, means a deep self-consciousness or insecurity. The idea that if someone really knew you or really put you to the test, really examined you, really thoroughly turned things over, they wouldn't like what they found, and that you ultimately would be rejected or unfit. It's a feeling that if people really knew deep down how proud you were, how bitter you were, how sad you were, how anxious you were, that they wouldn't give you the time of day because deep down you really don't believe that you deserve it. And our entire lives kind of swirl around this concept, and we do lots of things throughout our entire time here in our experience, whether it's trying to find success academically, whether it's trying to find success professionally, whether it's trying to find success in who we, you know, becomes our significant other and what we pursue in terms of relationships, or maybe it's financial success. We do a lot of things to try and make ourselves come to the place where we can feel like we're finally okay and we're finally fit. In many ways, we're bringing offerings and sacrifices into the tent just like those Old Testament priests were, trying to figure out how to come to a place where things are finally the way that they were supposed to be again. The issue for us right now is that the Hebrew writer is saying that these religious ordinances that he's referring to, this old sacrificial system, those good works, those things that we do, even the things that are according to the letter of God's law, can never deal with this conscience problem that we have. Sure, they can't take away sin, but even more pressing in the back of your mind is that they can't really deal with the problem that you know is in you. They can never take away shame. They can never take away that stain. And they can't get rid of this insidious intuition that we have deep down that we are not enough, we are not good enough, we are not fit to be seen, we are not fit to be heard, we're not fit to be trusted, and therefore we can't be authentic and we can't be vulnerable. Our best course of action is to hide from any place or anything or any opportunity where we might come under intense scrutiny. And that hurts us because as disciples of Jesus, we're designed to be in community. And if you don't feel fit and you can't be vulnerable and you can't be accountable, then you can't be in community. So we're at an impasse here. Guilt deals with what you have done, but the shame of an evil conscience that the Hebrew writer is talking about deals with who and what you are, how you appear and feel presently. That is altogether different. The section of Hebrews isn't just calling, you know, into criticism the inefficacy of the Old Testament system. It's not just saying that these things were not good enough to work. It's illuminating that all of us, even we in 2020, are in the same tent every single day, year after year. Some of us Sunday after Sunday, going to church services, trying to find a way to deal with the shame that we feel. Trying to find a way to deal with these consciences that we've had ever since the fall in the garden. Trying to find a way to subdue our consciousness into that peace and trying not to let people see how weak we truly believe that we are deep down. Here's how I know. And you can know if you're still in the tent trying to fix things yourself if you've ever said something like this or felt something like this. I know that God has forgiven me, but I don't think I can ever forgive myself. You see, you can know intellectually that Jesus' sacrifice is greater and it's enough and that it has taken away sin. But in your conscience, in your heart, intuitively, instinctively, there's still a part of you where it hasn't come home. If you've ever been in that place, I think we probably all have, or even maybe all of us are to some extent right now. This is the conscience that the Hebrew writer is talking about in chapter 9 and chapter 10. And we're still in the tent, offering sacrifices, trying to fix ourselves, trying to be our own savior, trying to feel fit for the presence of God and whoever else. But the scripture says, with that approach, with that worldview, with that understanding, we will never, ever get there. We have a scary situation on our hands because even in my own life, not too long ago, I had an experience that revealed in me just how much I relied on this way of thinking in this worldview. I remember I was struggling mightily with something and I had committed an incredible amount of will and discipline each and every day to not continue to make the same mistake again and again and again. And I thought in my mind and in my heart that if I could get rid of this thing, then I would be so much better. I would be near, not perfect, but I felt like it was the biggest problem in my life. And I did, through sheer willpower and prayer and discipline, I did have a great run for a long time where I didn't fall into that same situation. And then one day I did. And I remember sitting in my house, and I remember with my head in my hands, just coming apart and undone, saying to God, I can't believe that I did this again. I promised that I would never do this again. I am absolutely worthless. I was doing so good. And as soon as the word good came out of my mouth, it was like a bolt of lightning struck me. Conviction. I know this conviction came from God. At that moment, it just became clear to me that my actual problem, or my bigger problem, I should say, was not that I had messed up again, but that I had been keeping score. And that as long as I thought I could do it, that I could be good enough, that I could bring a sacrifice worthy to be in the presence of God, that I could make myself perfect through willpower and through perfect putting myself perfect in word and in deed, as long as I thought and as long as my faith was in my ability to do that and just be better, then I was doing dead good works. I was bringing a sacrifice to the tent every day, a sacrifice that could never fix my conscience, and a sacrifice that actually wasn't dealing with my sin. But here's the thing. In that moment, I also realized that there was only one person in the room that was surprised that I had made that mistake again. Because if I really believe in the omnipotence of God, if I really believe in the omnipresence of God, if I really believe that He has indeed seen the end from the beginning, and that He is working all things together, and that He knows me from top to bottom, every hair on my head, then there was only one person who was surprised in that room that I made that mistake. And it wasn't God. And it wasn't Jesus. It was me. Yet He decided to give Himself as the greater sacrifice anyway. And so Christ's sacrifice is greater, greater than any sacrifice, deed, or work that you can bring, greater than any observance of the religious letter of the law, everything that you can think of that you could do to perfect yourself. Christ's sacrifice is greater. Being a good person won't work. Being a good Christian won't work. Getting things right that you used to get wrong won't work. Getting all the boxes checked won't work. Everything that you can muster to try and live a good enough life won't work. Only Christ's sacrifice will. When all is said and done, if your heart is occupied by anxiety, if your heart is occupied and crippled by fear, then that is the evidence of the evil conscience spoken of here in chapter 10. What I want to say as we're closing down today is that we have to be able to willingly admit that we can't fix what we want to fix. We have to be willing and able to leave it to Jesus to do what He has promised to do and to have finished what He finished on the cross. You see, in chapter 9, verses 24 through 26, the scripture says that Christ's sacrifice perfects us as worshipers by putting away the sin that we obsess over. And it says that being made perfect in Hebrews chapter 10 and verse 2 means that we now have no more consciousness of sin, that our conscience has been purified, that we are purified from dead works and freed to serve in the kingdom now, chapter 9 and verse 14. What's interesting about chapter 9 and verse 14, if you go there for just a second, is that it doesn't say that Christ's sacrifice just purifies us from our dead bad works. We know from other places in Scripture that it absolutely does. But actually says something that has further reach here. It says that it purifies us from our dead good works. And in this context, those are those religious observances that couldn't deal with sin. Those are those things that people tried to do to save themselves and become their own savior. In other words, Christ's greater sacrifice sets us free from our box checking, and it sets us free from the same problem that the Old Testament sacrificial system was unable to answer. Christ's sacrifice is a greater because it brings our dead good works alive by allowing us to do them for the right reasons. It will change the motives of your heart. See, Christ's greater sacrifice changes the nature of our good works. It changes the nature of our relationship with God. In Christ's greater sacrifice, we see the redemptive power of self-sacrifice, the scandalous power of God's plan, the kind of sacrifice that is great enough once and for all to not just put away sin, but to purify your conscience and to make perfect, as the scripture says, those who are being sanctified in chapter 10, verses 10 through 14. In spite of our flaws and our sins, they've been put away and set aside so that we can appear fit and perfect in the presence of God now. This is what we have to fix our eyes on. This is what deals with our conscience. You will never overcome sin by obsessing on the sin. You will overcome sin by obsessing on Jesus and what he has done for you lovingly and willingly, despite the brokenness that he is already aware of. Look deeply into the gospel. Look deeply at the cross. Look deeply at Jesus as he sacrificed himself to absorb your conscience from the obsession that has crippled it with fear and anxiety from the time you realized the knowledge of good and evil. The only thing that will put your conscience back together is the only thing that will put your sin away. It's the only thing that will ever make you actually okay. To know that Jesus loved you enough to do this, to be the greater sacrifice. And so with that, I just want to remind you, we all sacrifice. We all bring our offerings to the tent. We all know that this world is broken. We all intuitively know that we are broken too. So we all bring our offerings. We try to live a good life. We try to find success. We try to be liked. We try to be respected. We try to be perfect in religion. We try to cover the stain. We try to find a way to make things okay. But as long as your relationship with God is relying on what you bring, you will never experience the redemptive, freeing, and purifying power of the greater sacrifice. One more question. Are you living like a Christian right now? If your answer is, I'm trying, then you don't yet understand the power of the greater sacrifice. You're not yet free. You're still bringing sacrifices to the temple to try and make things okay, to try and be good enough. My encouragement for you is that at some point you have to stop looking at Jesus and what he's done and allowing your conscience to tell him that it wasn't good enough to finish the job for you. What's the difference between the old covenant and a group of modern disciples today? People under the old covenant are insecure. They did not have the work of Christ. They had dead good works. They were a moral people. They were a self-righteous people. They were a religious people, but they were a people that were constantly in the tent offering again and again, as the scripture says, day by day and year after year, always with the sense that they were never as good as they should or ought to have been. A Christian is able to absolutely rest in their conscience, absolutely rest in the unshakable truth of God's love and sacrifice for them. It's important to see that both people repent of their sins, but the person under the old sacrificial system is forced to be obsessed with their sin continually. The Christian, though, is obsessed with Christ. The Christian looks back and realizes that they're broken and that sometimes even the good works that they have done for the wrong reasons to be their own savior. They thought that if I do this, then God will have to. The person under the old covenant does good deeds with incredible vigor, but out of fear and for themselves, not for God or for the love of God. But the gospel is different because Jesus' sacrifice is greater. It's greater than anything you can bring. It's a sacrifice that allows us to draw near. And it says in chapter 10, verses 16 and 17, that it is this transformation and in this moment that God writes his law on your heart. His law becomes something that you desire to do, that you want to do, not something that you're forced to do to keep the letter of the code. The good works that you do, you no longer do because you are forced to do them. You do them because you want to please and abide with the one who would rather be crushed for you than to see you crushed. When you receive this gospel, When you accept the gift that Jesus is, the greater sacrifice, you can finally stop bringing your sacrifices to the tabernacle. You can stop desperately trying to bring something to God that will fix what you know is wrong with you. You can, with boldness and confidence, as the Hebrew writer says, approach the throne of grace, and you can begin living no longer for inward justification, but you can begin living outward from grace for the kingdom. Now your relationship with God isn't about your sin, but about the purpose He has for you in His kingdom. I'm reminded of Titus chapter 2, verses 11 through 14, which read, "For the grace of God has appeared, bringing salvation for all people, training us to renounce ungodliness and worldly passions and to live self-controlled, upright, and godly lives in the present age, waiting for our blessed hope, the approaching of the glory of our great God and Savior Jesus Christ, who gave Himself for us to redeem us from all lawlessness and to purify for Himself His own possession, a people who are zealous for good works." Jesus is the greater sacrifice. So I say, let us draw near with a true heart in full assurance and faith, with our own hearts sprinkled clean from an evil conscience and our bodies washed in pure water. Jesus is greater.
There's a fountain free, 'tis for you and me. Let us haste, oh haste, to its brink. 'Tis the fount of love from the source above, and He bids us all freely drink.
Glad you joined in today. We got to commune with the Lord. We got to praise His name. We heard a good word. Tell someone about it. Tell someone about what you've experienced today. And let's go live the word and be an example. Let's be salt and light. And let's pray that God will give us the strength to apply His word and to carry out His will this week. Would you join me? Father, thank you so much for a great worship service today. Thank you for teaching us how to connect with you. Father, we want to obey you. We want to please you. You're our creator and our maker. Father, would you give us strength? Would you give us wisdom? Would you give us opportunity also? Help us to look at the world as you see the world. and to be able to reach out to our neighbor and help them by speaking and doing your will. Thank you so much, and bless your name, dear Father. In Jesus we pray. Amen.